Welcome to the Wine Lux International Award 2020 result announcement. Today we are very happy here in the Renaissance Hotel, so we can share the result of this year with our chairman, Mr. Nelson Chow.
Yeah.
This year, I think, is a very difficult year because of the pandemic, and we can't invite the international judge here to Hong Kong. But luckily, of course, with Nelson and the team from the Hong Kong Sommelier Association, and it's a very smooth, and I think we're still going very successful.
Yeah, it's pretty good result, actually. With such a difficult situation, a lot of winemaker or company that they are not able to send those products in time.
Yeah.
But at the end, we still have 148 products in tasting, which is pretty good result already.
Yeah.
And at the end, even though we don't have the overseas judges, but we have 56 different wine and spirit professions.
Yes.
Come to join us.
Yeah. I think that's a really good to see that we all together in the industry, and we all support each other, and of course we have lots of wine professional and spirit professional in Hong Kong. So that's why we can do a very good job for the judges.
Yes.
Yeah. So maybe let's see the video about the judging period, and you can see. Our judge and the professional, and during the tasting, I think there are lots of happening. And so you can have a look of the video. Okay, so now, Nelson, so we maybe let's start the announcement of the overall first.
Yeah. So, well, actually, because our competition is really wide range and complete, that's why we separate into a few different categories, like the new well, red wine and white wine, old well, red and white wine. I don't call old well normally, but anyhow. Okay, we also have a category in sparkling. We also have the whiskey, gin, and also other spirits, right? That's why it's quite a lot of different categories. And also in the results, we also have different awards to them as well. Firstly, all the wine has been tasted with different group of judges. And then after they taste, they need to combine the result and through discussion to find out the real award for that wine. That's why it's in a very, very fair manner. And we have like the gold awards, we also have the silver award, we also have the bronze award, but also we have categories of seal approval, but we don't list the seal approval. Okay, but at the end, all the gold trophy wines will be grouped by their categories and by a final judge panel to taste again in a separate room, separate person. Okay, and then at the end, that 24 different judges rate the best of the best that we call the Platinum Awards of each category. That means each category, you will have only one Platinum wine.
Yes.
Is it?
Yeah, I remember that they, we have lots of discussion.
Yes.
And a very long discussion.
Yeah.
Because
even though there's not a lot of go-to free wine.
Yeah.
But the discussion is much longer than the tasting.
Yes. Yeah. I remember there's a very long discussion for the platinum, and of course, and I think it's a very good sign because different professionals and different opinion, but we come up a very good tasting and also come up the final is the best of the best.
Yeah, because at the end, all wines are being blind tasted. Mm. They can only see the glass, not even the bottle.
Yeah, yeah.
They only see the wine in the glass.
Yeah.
They can't see the bottle or the shape or the tag or anything.
Yes.
They can't guess from that part.
Yeah, So that's why, so let's have a look at the result of the
old world first.
Yeah,
right?
The old world.
Why don't we go for the gold trophy first, right?
Yeah. Maybe we see the bronze and the silver on the screen first.
Okay. Let's do that.
So let's see the bronze award.
Then the silver.
Then the silver. Okay. So let's talk about the gold trophy.
The gold trophy. Well,
yeah.
in the old world categories, white wine category.
Yeah.
Actually, relatively small entry this time.
Mm.
Okay, but still we can find two bottles of very very nice white wine, and afterward they get one in the gold category, and the other one is upgraded into the platinum category.
Okay,
in the gold category we have the Scara. Scara is Acqua di Luna.
2018.
This one is really very nice from the Sicilia, right?
Yeah.
And this Italy.
One, I want to mention, this one is a very special wine making by the Hong Kong guy. And Hong Kong people, I think we should be proud of him because he did a very good job.
Well, farming in Akla is really, really difficult because they are all the lava soil. And then it's all really slippery, sloppy.
Yeah.
And then they need to use a special technique, how to use the stone and the rack, how to hold the liver soil not being rinsed off.
Yeah.
That's why it's kind of a
And I remember
technique.
The tasting is also very good. And some judges really like this wine. they try again. Yeah. And again, after we know the result.
Yeah. We go for the red. Well, the red, of course, everyone know that in all the traditional world, like the major European wine, there's quite a lot of entrants.
Yes.
But we discovered quite a lot of gold trophy wine actually this time.
Yeah.
Okay. We have the Baton and Gastier, the Chateau Monu, 2018. This one actually is a very nice bottle wine. You know, B&G is one of the biggest négociant in bottle. Okay, the other one is Immortelle. Immortelle is from the Côte d'Or, 2017. And it's from the Vineyard Production. There is like a kind of a cooperative, but actually they do a very, very good job in that.
Okay.
Then the other one is really coming from Toro. Toro Reserva Level, which is from Spain, Toro region, and is made by Grace Harvest.
Grace Harvest.
Yeah, actually, the Grace Harvest is owned by Hong Kong people as well.
Yeah. It's a very, very nice wine also.
But they sent a 2008 bottle, a very, very good one. Yeah. The Reserva, they have certain kind of requirement. They already need to reserve for a period of time. Okay. Then after that is the Cordero El Sagrado. Sagrado 2017. Actually, this one is a Spanish wine as well.
Yeah.
Very, very nice one. Okay. Then we also have the other one, which is from Saint-Emilion Grand Cru. This time is from the other négociant, Chorio. Chorio 2010. Okay. One of the best year I recognize in bottle. A lot of people underrate about 2010. I think it can really, in certain extent, close to the 1982.
1982.
Yeah, but the wine is a little bit more masculine. Needs some more time. But 2010 will be very, very good. Of course, the other legendary is 2016.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. But 2010, I think some people compare with the 2009.
Nah. Yeah, well, I did that all the time. Yeah. Whenever I went to Bordeaux, Satu by Satu visits, I always ask for two vintage together.
Yeah.
I find that 2009 is really charming. Fruit-driven, they have a huge potential. But for the characteristics, 2010 is more into a classic Bordeaux.
Okay.
Classic Bordeaux year is accurate, as I said, is a little bit more masculine.
Yeah.
When it's young, it's really tight, really holding. But 2009, because it's a big year, very fruit driven, a little bit more like what we say, New World style.
Oh,
okay, 2009.
Okay.
That's why it's a totally different character. Some people absolutely will like the 2009, but for people who love saving Bordeaux, they will love 2010.
Yeah, okay. So the last one of the gold medal.
Yeah, Domaine du Castel, Grand Vin 2018. This one actually is really interesting, right?
Yeah.
This is from Israel.
Yeah, from Israel.
This one is from Israel. This one is actually a very unique wine.
Yeah.
And Castel, of course, is a very big merchant from Bordeaux as well. Okay. They also have different wine from France, but they also start their own casting in Israel as well. That's why it's a very interesting wine.
Yeah.
Surprise is really the favoring agents and everything, pretty much like Bourgogne.
Really?
Lighter, refreshing,
but
the strength is there. The aftertaste is really long. That's why this one is really interesting.
Really interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, so so the next category will be...
No, we go for the Platinum Toby.
Yeah.
As said, each category will have only one wine. And the overall white wine go to the Domaine du Castel as well. They send the red and white.
Yeah.
The red go to the gold trophy. The white is the winner of the category.
Yeah.
Actually, they put very, very seriously Chardonnay. And the favoring agent is really much alike, like the Bouilly Montrachet. A lot of people surprised about that. After we discover, it's an Israel wine. Everybody tastes again and again. You know, it's really interesting one.
Do you think Israel wine is an up and coming rising star? Because actually, we have a column in the WINE.LUXE magazine. It's right about Israel wine. Yeah, I think that is so. Maybe more and more people they would like to explore. And in the Bible, in the Bible, always mention about wine. So that's why I think there are lots of wine making in Israel in the old times. And now they are coming back, maybe. What do you think?
Well, how should I say? I believe each country have their own strength. In particular area, and particularly most important is the winemakers. If they really know the soil, if they really know the climate, and they know their grapes, they can always make a good wine. But if you talk about the trend, I don't think Israel wine will be an upcoming trend. It is quite difficult because transportation itself and also a lot of political issues. That's why I don't see a big change in that. But if you say for a sommelier like me, looking for some unique, special tech wine, that would be
really
something
special.
And also, at the moment, because they are not very well known. The price issue is still very, very reasonable.
Okay.
That's why I love to discover a lot of wine like that. And I have no hesitation to introduce this wine to anyone. You know, it's reasonable, and then you can really drink a bottle of good wine, and then
that's good. That's a good news for the Israel wine.
Yeah.
So so this is
One more. Yeah.
One more.
You call the overall red wine. Overall red wine. We also have a very unique wine. Actually, this one is Sondari. Sondari Sontari actually is a Bucelli Superiore. Mean that is a DOC. Now you can call DOC already because Bucelli is already classified as that. You see, but this one is a cabinet base. Same thing in Tuscany. Normally you don't call cabinet sauvignon or cabinet franc major to be a DOC wine, but Bucelli, being the history, they certify into a DOC already.
Yeah.
That's why Bucelli Superiore can be a DOC. And then this wine is a combination really much like a bottle brand. Cabernet Sauvignon, yeah. Cabernet Franc, and Merlot.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this wine, after open, it's 2016, pretty young. But the fruit agent is really wrong, and because I am part of the tasting, so yeah. I didn't say a word because the judge panel make that decision. But being the president, I also taste all the wine. And then I remember this wine is really big round fruit, well balanced, acidity just right. And then up to now on, you can enjoy the fruit agents all around. But at the end, you really need to wait a little bit longer. This wine can stay for the other 8-10 years, have no problem at all.
Yeah.
Then afterward, I think you need to finish in within 15 years time. But the wine is really perfect and also reasonable in price.
So we're looking for something like this because the good quality with the reasonable price, and we can promote, and of course we can try at home now because sometimes we need to buy something drink from home. It's not a work.
Also, this wine is coming from a very, very well received, very open-minded wine company in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
Actually, their base is in Japan, but actually they did a
very
good job.
We can say the Enoteca. So if you want to buy, you can go to Enoteca.
Yeah, actually, you can go there. They have a few wine shops around town. You can go and find this wine directly.
Yeah, so that's good. So now, so we finished the first part is the old world category. And so the next one will be the new world. And but before that, let's see some comment and the experience from our judges. So let's have a video.
大家好，我系廖碧儿啦。咁今次参加呢一个 WINE.LUXE International 2020 Awards，其实我都参加咗几年噶啦。咁今年咧，当然喺呢一个疫情 之间咧，其实已经算搞得好好，大家都好受规矩啦。咁，throughout this whole competition, I guess I participated in 2 out of 3 days, and I also got to take part in the best of the best. 咁我觉得，成个 organization 系好专业啦。It's very professional, especially during this COVID period. So everybody were separated by tables. Everybody had their face masks on and only took them off while we were tasting. And at the same time, doing the interviews. And I think that the organization of it, because of the time, the manpower that needed to be increased in order to do this competition, you've got to give a hand to the organization itself. And hopefully for the coming year, it just shows that the professionalism behind the awards and behind the WINE.LUXE group is obviously improving and obviously taking care of everybody's needs. And I think that the wines showed today for the best of the best was very, very good, and hope to see more participation in the next year.
I would like to congratulate WINE.LUXE for this event. This has been the 5th year that we are doing this wine challenge. The wines which we judged, where we found them with a very good quality, almost of all of them, they are really good wines that we tasted during these 3 consecutive days. I hope that even with the crisis of COVID-19, we're still going on with the event, and hopefully that next year will be much greater, with a very softening of the COVID-19 pandemic. I would like just to thank you very much for WINE.LUXE, for the organization. So they did a really good job. And of course, looking after to see you all together next year. Thank you.
Okay, so after the first part of the result, so now we have Cecilia Wong. very famous columnists and also the wine judges in Hong Kong. And so very happy to have you in the judging panel.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I know so you write lots of the wine and spirits. And how about you think the tasting this year in the WINE.LUXE International Awards?
Well, you know, due to COVID-19, I think, you know, obviously when I joined, I don't expect to have so many wines or spirits to try and to judge. And I feel so happy and excited to meet all our, you know, friends
here.
Like all the other wine judges and the people in the industry.
Yes.
And surprisingly, like the result, it's you told me that there are quite a lot of entries for the new world in this situation as well. It's like around 70. Entries.
Yeah.
So, but we are very happy to see that the result is we blind taste all the wine and spirits, and it turned out to have like the New World Red and the New World White wine. And for the New World Red, we have like 7 gold awards.
Yeah, very good. And so actually, for the result, I think this year not too many in totally. The amount is not as much as last year, but I think we still have very good quality wine.
Right.
And also some newcomer, and we never try, and we have a very good result, and we find something interesting. Yeah, so so this year, I think for the New World, I think more aggressive than the Old World, because we have more entries from the New World, and also have a more good result. So firstly, maybe we can have a look of the bronze medal.
Okay.
So let's see. And the second part would be the silver medal. Let's talk about the gold. Yeah, so the gold medal, so we, I think, just like you said, we have the even more gold medal from the New World.
Yes.
And so let's take a look of the gold medal of the New World white wine.
Yes. So for the first one is congratulations to the Awata Sauvignon Blanc 2019.
Yes. And the second one will be
the Venture and Company, the Dividing Line 2018.
Yes.
And the other gold, the third one, will be the Terraces de Los Andres Reserve Chardonnay 2019.
Yeah, so actually for me, I tried the last one. I think that one is a really interesting white wine, because it's a reserve Chardonnay, and with a really strong and a really complex Chardonnay. So I think it's the only one I've tried, because I'm not the judge. But this one I remember, and a very good memory about the taste. So this one is really good.
I think it's, you know, when we do blind tasting in a competition, like as a judge, since we have like different flights to try, and sometimes if it's like what you said, it's a very outstanding and complex white wine, then it's very easy to recognize and remember.
Yes.
Congratulations to all the three white wines. And for red, we have more for the New World, right?
Yeah, so let's have a look at
it. Yes, so congratulations to Dynasty Merlot Dry Red Wine, the gold label.
Yeah, wow, this one is from China.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we all know Dynasty very well.
Yeah. And this one, I think we also have tried a few times, and in the past few years, they also joined the competition and with a very good result. And even some
of the... I remember, because I also joined as judge for a few years.
Yeah.
And we also give them like very high marks in the end after the blind tasting.
Yeah, after the blind tasting, this one, that, I think very interesting. Some of the sommelier we taste together, and many people asking, oh, this wine from which country? And so finally, oh, this is from China. So some of the sommelier, they really, wow.
Surprise.
And but this wine, so I think we have a very good judging, and also we can say this is a really a good wine, because after a few years, also have the good result.
Right.
So the next one.
Next one is Vina Casablanca Nimbus Merlot 2017.
Okay.
Congratulations. And we also have the Hague Sorry. We also have Hecking Botham Cabernet Sauvignon 2017.
Yes.
And then we have the Freemark Abbey Merlot 2016. Mm. And we also have Keyser Hills Wine Cabernet Sauvignon from Clare Valley 2017.
This one, I want to say something about them. Because this wine is from the, of course, it's from Australia.
Yes.
But
Clare Valley.
Clare Valley. But the owner is from Hong Kong.
Ah.
The owner is from Hong Kong. So I think they make a very good job, and it's not a very big winery, but they starting to do something in Hong Kong, and so they join this competition. And. And the Hong Kong owner is very passionate, and they want to make something different.
Mm.
At least, I think they want to make something for pairing, like the
Chinese food,
Cantonese food, and also is suitable for Hong Kong style, and even in China. So I think they want to make some effort. So I think they win the gold medal is a really really happy, and so happy for them.
It's very interesting, because in Australia, not only this winery, but some other wineries are also owned by Hong Kong people as well.
Yeah.
So congratulations again.
Congratulations.
And talking about Australian wine, there's another one who has won the gold.
Yeah.
That is a Wolf Blass Grey Label Shiraz 2016.
Yeah. And this one's also, I think, many people know about Wolf Blass.
Mm.
And
you can find them very easily in supermarkets everywhere. Yeah.
And but the Grey Label, I think they also something make something different, and especially they want to make a higher level of wine, and also sometimes they promote the Grey Label in the restaurant. And some of the, I heard that some of the sommelier and many restaurants, they willing to do some pairing with the Grey Label. Because I think many people think about Wolf Blass is really mass market.
But they have like different color like different range.
Yeah, yeah. But this one I think is good for the people they want to taste Wolf Blass, but a higher level, and for the restaurant, and also for the food and wine pairing. Sometimes they can do something interesting.
Mm.
So I think maybe have a try.
I actually have attended like a blind tasting with a different range of Wolf Blass, and also it's like a judgment day. Yeah, so it's like I've tried it with like Bordeaux, First Grove, and like different wines, wine tasting.
And
we have like that day, we have like around 50 industry people. So we don't know, we know that there are some like First Grove, or maybe some are the like the top lines from Napa Valley and so on. And but we don't know which is which, because that's wine tasting. So we did like two flights, around like 20 wines, and then some of them are of course the Grey Label Wolf Blass, and we turn out that the marks are top three for the Wolf Blass. So so it's like we were also very surprised and happy to know that you know, sometimes you cannot you cannot judge by just seeing the bottle or label, but judge by the taste and the quality itself.
Yeah, so that's why so when we do blind tasting and also the judging, so sometimes we have some surprise. But I think it's good, because so don't just look at the label.
Yes.
Yeah, believe your taste.
Yes. And let's also congratulate the last red wine who get gold. That is the Wakefield Taylor's Family Wines Merlot 2019.
Yes, okay. Taylor's also very active and also very supportive winery. They always joining us in the past few years also. But I also really enjoyed the wine from Taylor's, especially this Merlot. I like the fruit, because the fruitiness is really rich, and I think this wine also can be tried. And if you want to have some fruit pairing and also like the fruitiness, and then you can try this one.
Okay, so shall we move to the platinum now?
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, the platinum wine. So just like
for the New World side, we have three platinum, right?
Two.
Red and white.
Red and white. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so maybe the white first.
Okay, congratulations to the Newton Vineyard, which is the unfiltered Chardonnay 2016 from Napa Valley.
Yeah, congratulations. And for this wine also, I've tried a few times, and Newton also a big brand.
Yes.
And from the MHD.
Yes.
And this one we have tried for a few times, because it's really rich in the fruitiness and also very concentrated.
Mm.
I like this type of Napa Valley, you know, the
rich
American,
and fruit forward, yeah, and with
American style.
The oak barrel, yeah, with the very nice, complex,
yeah, but
and
still,
easy to drink, the vanilla drink, and fruit forward style.
And balanced, but is it still really balanced? Because sometimes, you know, the American Chardonnay too strong, but this
is
one I think is okay.
More subtle,
yeah,
like more balanced
and balanced. So and I think this one's not too expensive, so worth to try.
Right. So so you can look for it, and because this one has won the platinum.
Yeah.
Among all the New World white wines.
Yes.
Okay. So let's announce for the New World red wine. Platinum goes to the Wakefield Taylor's St. Andrew's Shiraz 2018. Congratulations.
Congratulations. And this one's also, I like the St. Andrew's Shiraz with the also very good fruitiness, but it's very concentrated and very strong. The style of the Australian, you know, Shiraz.
Right.
And it's really signature. And I think among all the judges, and they tried and also discussed for a few times, and this one is very outstanding.
For the complexity?
Yeah, for the complexity and also the fruitiness, and express the St. Andrew's Shiraz, this really a signature style. Yeah, so this is also very memorable.
For this type.
And
so this Shiraz is from Clare Valley.
Clare Valley, yeah. And so this is the list of the
red and white.
Red and white New World. And the next one, we have to see the sparkling.
Okay.
Yeah. For the sparkling wine, I think very interesting. This year, the sparkling wine, we have lots of discussion.
Right.
And also very surprised. And there's some
the result.
Of the, yeah, some of the result. It's really interesting. So let's take a look. It's a silver category for the sparkling wine.
Okay, congratulations for the Gold Awards goes to the Banffy Rosa Regale DOCG.
Yeah, and this one, very nice.
It's a rosé sparkling.
I think it's not really only rosé, it's just like the red wine. Red sparkling, and it's really deep red, just like this one, just a little bit. Yeah, I like this one, and also some of my friends and the judges really love this style of the sparkling, because it's just like red wine, but it's sparkling and also a little bit sweet.
So
and
it's like Lambrusco style.
Yes. And so that is just like the for many girls.
Yes.
My wife and
yes.
Easy to drink, and it just. I remember just like 7% alcohol. It's really easy to drink. Yes. So it's a very good one.
So maybe you can try as well.
Yeah,
and the other one is also an interesting sparkling
wine. Interesting,
congratulations to Dynasty 5 degree sparkling wine.
Yeah, and this one I remember when we do the judging, and I heard about the discussion from the judges and the sommelier. Also wonder where it come from. So after tasting, after lots of discussion, and many of them asking, this wine, where it's come from? From France or from Australia? And then finally, this is from China. And after I try also, this is amazing. I can't imagine it's from China and this sparkling wine, and never thinking about this so good. And also sometimes, you know, some years ago, and we've tried the Dynasty sparkling wine, it's not like this. This type of, they have
so
new,
they have
new
like
packaging,
improvement.
It's a new one, and this one is
but I would say, like, from like a more generic perspective, like you can see China has more and more wineries. And besides that, you can see a lot of different like the big wineries also invested in China. To have their own wineries in China or to collaborate as well. And we also can tell, like, Shandong also have the sparkling wine in China as well. So I can see that and foresee that there will be more and more interesting Chinese sparkling wine coming up as well. Apart from the red wine and white wine, we all know that they have improved and, you know, a lot in these 10 years.
Yeah, and hopefully the trend can be keep going in, especially in China market, because I think in the traditional concept in China, we don't have lots of the sparkling, but only the beer. But now I think if there are more and more sparkling winemaking in China, I think, and I hope they can make a trend in China market, and that would be I think would be great for many different countries winery if they want to go into China. And then maybe they have more potential.
Okay. So let's move on to another one. You know, when we talk about sparkling wine, we all like champagne. And this one is a champagne. It's Champagne Langsong and Gold Label Vintage 2009. Congratulations.
Congratulations. This also very, very nice champagne.
And the complexity and, you know, because of the layers, different layers that you can tell, it's not just, you know, a non-vintage champagne. It's a 2009 vintage and it gets more complexity when you try it. And the last but not the least for the sparkling wine, so it goes to Fina Copa Caprice Marine Brut 2019.
Congratulations.
Yes, congratulations. Fina Copa, I have tried this this winery and it's also very interesting, and surprisingly to me, they have like the champagne method, which is because they cannot say it's champagne. It's not from Champagne. But then the champagne method, it's quite complex. And I know that apart from gold, they also
won more,
win another award, right?
It's the platinum.
So the platinum goes to the Fina Copa Caprice Rosé. It's, well, actually this one for the winery, it's from Slovenia. So it's a very interesting country, Slovenia. So it's different. I mean, because in Hong Kong, we cannot find a lot of Slovenian wine. So if you want to try, and it's in Hong Kong now.
And also, I think after we try, and with the judges and also with some friends, they all love this. Yeah, just like before we mentioned about the Benfi one, and this one is a rosé, but also with a really really good and nice taste of just like strawberry and some fruits, and the color is very beautiful. And also many people asking, oh, where it's come from? Oh,
Slovenia.
Slovenia. So actually this year, so that's why we find something really interesting, because just like the old world, we find some wines from Israel with a very good result, and this time from the Slovenia, we also find something really different, and surprisingly they can get a very good medal. So this is I think this year we have something really interesting happen.
Great. Congratulations.
Congratulations. And so the next part, so let's have a look of the international judges from the overseas, because in the past few years we have many judges from different countries, and they mentioned about the WINE.LUXE International Award, and hopefully next year we can invite them to come Hong Kong again. So let's have a look first.
Hi, I'm delighted to be back at the show again. I think this is one of the really top shows that there is in Asia. My third year of chairing the show, so I had a break away from it last year, but I'm really delighted to be back.
Hello, I'm Liam Stevenson, Master of Wine. I come from the UK. I live and work out of Bristol in the UK, and so this is actually, I think, the third or fourth time I've been here. It's always a privilege to come here to Hong Kong, which is a great city, of course, and also to judge on this really, really well-organized competition and taste a collection of wines which I think are fascinating, interesting, really represent the global market.
I'm Kees van Kastel, Master Wine from Amsterdam in Holland. I've been judging for the past 3 days at the WINE LUXE Awards in Hong Kong. And I must say, I've been quite impressed with both the offer of wines and my fellow judges in this competition.
Hi, my name is Brendan Heath. I was one of the judges here this year at the WINE LUXE competition. It was a great opportunity to come here to Hong Kong and see, mix with a bunch of different people, but also to see a bunch of different wines from all over the world and to get a good understanding of what's going on with the Hong Kong industry.
Okay, so this part is the last part of the result, and I'm really happy that we can invite the very well-known judges of the spirits and also very well-known mixologist, Mr. Eddie Nara.
Thanks, Nelson, for the invitation.
Yeah, and Eddie, we do lots of the judging, especially for the whiskey, gin, and spirits, and also work with many bar in Hong Kong and do his own recipe of the cocktails. And also, he is a very good whiskey writer and a connoisseur. I think he is a really, really capable and very good judge in our panel. And so this year, what do you think about the tasting when you do the judging?
I think like other judges say, I mean, it's. I think first of all, I was really glad that we can make this happen in 2020, given the situation. And surprisingly, you know, when I enter the room, I see, wow, there are so many entries. So congratulations for, you know, having a very successful competition.
Thank you.
And I mean, in terms of the spirit selection, again, it's very wide selection as well. Whiskies, gins, and a lot of liqueurs as well. Very nice liqueurs. And I think a lot of liqueurs are kind of underrated. So I hope through this competition, a lot of the liqueurs, you know, will get more known to the people out there. Yeah,
and actually, I think the trend, especially for whiskey, for gin, is now in Hong Kong is really, really, really hit, and it's really trendy. And so, what do you think about after the judging, and how we can push the market and also to promote the whiskey and gin in different market like Hong Kong, China?
I think maybe it's a bit like wine, you know, for spirits in Hong Kong, there are a lot of importers, a lot of small importers.
Yeah.
Of course, we have the big guys as well.
Yeah.
But a lot of the nice items, whether it's whiskey or gin or liqueurs, a lot of them are being brought by maybe an individual or small company.
Yeah.
So you really need to know them well. Make sure they submit their products in the competition, work with them closely, and I guess, you know, once you've got these nice results, then you can promote to Southeast Asia, to mainland China.
Yes. So let's have a look of the firstly, we have a look of the bronze medals. So will be the silver medal. Okay, so now let's go into the gold medal first. And because this year we have lots of the whiskey and gin, so we separate the whiskey and gin into the independent category. And spirits, other spirits, we have another category. So firstly, let's have a look of the whiskey category. We have one gold medal.
Yes, the winner for the whiskey gold medal is actually a Scotch. So, you know, the traditional or sort of the old world of whiskey. So it's Scotch whiskey coming from an island called Arran. So that means the label of this whiskey is Arran. It's an Arran single malt 10-year-old. Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. And I think this whiskey I will try. And I feel it's really, of course, it's very signature style. But I don't think a 10-year-old so intense like this, and I feel it's really
right.
It amazing.
It all has to do with the maturation, you know. I mean, the year, of course, is an indication, but a lot of other influence, of course, the barrel they use, where they age it, new or old barrels. But Arran is actually an island, as I said, and this distillery, they only started in 2006, so a really, really new, it's still relatively a new a distillery. Mm. And I think the one we tasted was actually a new packaging. They just launched the new labels, packaging, new bottle as well, I think about 2 years ago.
Oh,
and this 10-year-old, I mean, I also drink it, you know, once a while.
Yeah.
It gives me a lot of memories of green fruits, the greeniness, nice maltiness. So it is a textbook Scotch, you know, you know, bourbon barrel type, you know, whiskey. Yes. Yes.
That's good. That's good. So next, whiskey we have one go, and the next will be gin. Gin we have three go, and the first one will be Le Tribut gin, and this one I think is for me the packaging is very attractive because of the bottle with a different something. I think it's elegant and classic design, but I like the bottle and but also like the inside because. The gin is really also really refreshing and good to mix with the because they have the I remember they have their own tonic and
that's
so
right.
Mixed together and then that will be a perfect match. So this is the Tribut gin and the second one will be
the second one is from Japan, very close to Hong Kong.
Yes,
so this one is a Sakura gin original.
Yeah. And what about the gin from Japan? The gin market is quite also
yes, you actually see a lot of distillers, whether they've been making like traditional shochu or sake, they started to focus on the Western spirits, so whiskey, gin.
Yeah.
And this producer, Sakura, is actually based in Hiroshima.
Oh.
They are also a traditional family where they make a lot of shochu.
Yeah.
But only about 2018, where they started to make this Sakura gin.
Yeah.
And I think with this Japanese gin, the most interesting thing is majority of the botanicals they use are picked locally in Japan and in Hiroshima as well. So it's not just produced but also using a lot of elements from the surrounding areas.
So I think that is also the for me gin is really important. If you use the local ingredients and reflect and also to show the character from that area, I think that's very important.
And it is a very important selling point that about using local ingredients.
Yeah.
Because I know for a fact that you know this distillery, they've got another gin which they totally use only Japanese botanicals, including the juniper. So it's really very interesting.
Very interesting. And the next one's also, I think, is really interesting. It's the NIP gin.
We're moving closer to back home. This is from back home, yes.
Yeah. NIP, you know, is from Hong Kong.
Correct.
Yeah, I think in Hong Kong now, because gin is really, really popular.
Mm-hmm.
And so then happened, we have two distilleries in Hong Kong.
Yep.
NIP is one of them.
Official distillery.
Yeah, official.
Licensed distillery, yes.
Officially.
Yes.
And what do you think about the NIP?
Well, I mean, the founders, Jeremy and Nick, are my good friends. Mm. I think NIP gin is very juniper forward.
Mm.
It's got, you know, many botanicals in. A lot of them are also locally sourced.
Mm.
Apart from the juniper flavor, it also reminds me of osmanthus.
Mm, really?
Yes, so it's rather, I would say, very well made, very masculine, you know, all those botanical flavors.
Yeah.
And for me, as you mentioned that, I also make cocktails once in a while. I think for NIP gin, it's good to make those classic gin cocktails like Negroni. I think it really fits very well. Yes.
That's so interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next category will be spirits. So other spirits, I mean. Mm. So so there will be two different spirits from Moffedille Rich Cognac and Walnut Liqueur. And Moffedille Rich Roasted Macadamia Liqueur. So these two liqueur, have you tried this?
I probably have tried during the competition, but I've tried so many, so I just don't recall.
Yes,
and it's double blinded, so I I didn't know when I tried.
And when I tried these two liqueur, I found it's really really good because some other judges asking, oh, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
Because remind me of some of the popcorn.
Oh really? Okay.
The popcorn and also chocolate flavor. And actually, for this winery, I've been there a few years ago.
In Australia, right?
In Australia, yes. In Queensland.
Okay.
And very interesting because they make lots of different kinds of wine, but the liqueur also very
good. So it's a winery, but they happen to produce such a very nice liqueur spirit.
Nice liqueur, and I think it's really good if you try next time to make some cocktails and you can use this because the flavor is really
good. Sounds good. I think the ingredient is really it's not that common, so I think this is something that I can try to use.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
So after the gold medal, so next we go to the prepping.
So the best of the best.
Best of the best.
Best of the best spirits. Okay.
So best of the best. Yeah. Gin.
Okay. Well, this one is a gin, also very close. In geographically. Again, the two founders, Dimple and Ivan, are my good friends as well. So luckily, when I judge these gins, I didn't know what I'm tasting. Otherwise, it would be a very difficult decision. But congratulations, Dimple and Ivan.
Congratulations.
Two Moons. Again, you know, just started end of 2019. The gin, I would say, is very typical sort of gin that you find in the market.
Yeah.
But they use a lot of local ingredients as well. And this one for me is more on the feminine side.
It's different from the NIP because NIP, two fingers, a voice.
And it's I was going to say that, yes.
It's quite masculine.
Yes.
But this one's the mix, the distiller. Is a girl.
Yes, Dimple. So the master distiller. So I think it, you know, the character of the person also influences the product you make, especially in this case, you can tell.
It's
definitely more feminine, citrusy.
Yeah.
All the flavors are very well balanced. So again, you know, this is definitely a go-to gin for sipping, or even like a gin and tonic is definitely a perfect gin for it.
So really happy for them. And congratulations, 2 months. Okay, next one, whiskey.
Okay, so whiskey, the best of the best whiskey. Again, this one is also coming from Scotland. It's Glenallachie. Mm. It's a single malt whiskey, 12-year-old, from Speyside.
From Speyside?
Yes.
Yeah, so what do you think about this one?
I think this whiskey, again, it's a very typical Speyside character. You know, it's got a lot of fruitiness, floralness, honey characters. Mm. And I just have to say it's very well balanced.
And also a Speyside character. I always like this because for many beginner and for ladies and also like the whiskey from Speyside, right?
Yes. Because it's more easier to drink. It's more approachable. Yeah. That's why for beginners, but even connoisseurs like myself or yourself. Mm-hmm. I mean, it can be an everyday drinking type whiskey, yes. Yeah.
Not like Isla to PT. That kind is also another kind of masculine.
Yes.
And this is more easy and more approachable.
And it's also very versatile. You can drink it on its own, on rocks, or even make some whiskey cocktails, like a whiskey sour, or maybe like a Manhattan, you know, Rob Roy. This is a perfect whiskey to use.
Okay, yeah. Good. Okay, so lastly, we have the other spirits, Platinum.
Okay, so actually this is one of my favorite. This is Umeshu from Japan. It's from Okinawa. It's the Masahiro Umeshu Plum Liqueur, distributed by Lernic. Actually, the reason why I like this is because when I choose my Umeshu, the most important thing is it's got to have that plum sourness.
Okay.
If it's just pure sweetness with some plum hint flavor, that's not what I want. I'm not saying those are not good, but but for me to drink, or even especially to make cocktails, I want that sourness, that acidity coming from the plum. So I think this one is a very good. I think, you know, in the past I've made a few cocktails and I specifically asked for this to use because I really want to show that plum acidity into my cocktail.
So you speak for the cocktails and how to, so normally how to mix with the this kind of plum liqueur, to mix what kind of cocktail is better?
I think normally, you know, you can just use whiskey as a base and add some umeshu.
Yeah.
And if you want a bit more of the citrusiness, I would add either lemon juice or lime juice.
Yeah.
And if the sweetness is not enough, then you can add a bit more syrup and just shake it with ice.
Oh,
and that's a very easy way to make your whiskey umeshu cocktail.
Yes, nice.
Yeah.
And so you have a recipe now from Eddie.
Yes, or I'll make it for you.
Yes. Okay. So I think this is a very, very nice result and a very impressive, especially I'm really happy with the Hong Kong gin.
Yes, really congratulations to my friends. Yes.
Yeah. And so thank you. And this part, I think, is all about the spirits and the whiskey and gin. So lastly, let's have a look.
其實一個酒櫃對於我們一些葡萄酒的挑戰賽來說是非常重要的，尤其是在處理白葡萄酒方面，酒櫃是 一個最佳的選擇，白葡萄酒通常用傳統方法加冰塊或者水的時間，就好難控制一個適當的温度去點樣品嚐。但如果用酒櫃，因為你已經係定咗可以定咗個温度，只要譬如好似我哋期望嗰支酒係10度去飲用嘅，我只要搞到佢8度就啱啱好啦。當支酒係8度開瓶呼吸，跟住倒埋落杯搖埋嘅時間， 剛剛好就10度飲用。作為一個餐廳嘅營運裏面，其實酒櫃嘅幫忙真係非常之好嘅。有兩個最重要嘅元素，第一就係當展示之用啦，因為現時嘅酒櫃大部分都係玻璃門嚟嘅。第二呢，就係真真正正可以調控得到好適當嘅温度，最佳嘅酒櫃温度喺餐廳裏面8酒呢，就係8度左右。 但係去到sparkling，即係一啲我哋叫氣酒類嘅呢，我哋嘅appreciation喺6至8度之間啦，所以其實你 keep 到佢大概5到6度到呢，就係最佳嘅。咁至於紅酒方面呢，其實一般嚟講呢，我哋係需要擺喺16到18度之間。 咁但係呢，的而且確大家都知道香港 space 咧係非常之有限嘅，所以呢，可以有一類型嘅酒櫃呢，有唔同嘅溫區呢，絕對可以幫助得到呢喺我哋控制溫度嗰方面呢做得更加完美嘅。通常低溫區呢，多數都喺成個酒櫃嘅 lower part。 咁嗰度因為冷氣凝聚喺下低嘅時間呢，就要達到一個更加好嘅效果嘅。通常最底最底嘅位置呢，我哋就會放啲 sparkling 啦，因為嗰度應該係最凍嘅地方啦。 跟住呢，上少少嘅時間呢，就有一啲呢係 easy drinking 嘅 casual 啊，酸度好流暢嘅白酒啦，跟住又俾一啲 full body 啲嘅白酒啦，然後跟住去到最頂至會係紅酒啦。其實我哋挑選酒櫃嘅時間呢，最主要離唔開都係佢個温度嘅穩定性，因為葡萄酒的而且確對温度呢係非常敏感一個酒精類飲品，咁所以温度穩定性非常之重要啦。第二樣嘢我哋唔想見到嘅就係一個 vibration， 即係話講呢，唔想見到有好多嘅震動喺度，所以呢，盡量嚟講都係譬如佢哋行 compressor 嘅都好啦，係希望一啲微型啊或者係小震盪嘅 compressor 啦。
Okay, so that's all of our results today. And so I think this year, in a difficult year, but we still have a very good and successfully find the good wine for this year. And how about Nelson? How you think in the coming in this 2021st? And how to organize, and also what you think about the development in the wine industry and also the wine competition.
Now, even in the difficult years, we get such good results. I think 2021 will be a very promising year. Okay, up to this moment, a lot of uncertainty, but we have the vaccine, we have everything is really online, already. I think time will come back. A lot of predictions saying that the second half of the year will be everything booming, everything coming back.
Yeah.
We're of course looking forward to the good sign. Even the Olympic today mentioned already, must go on.
Must go on.
Okay. That's why I think we really having a good projection.
Yeah.
Since we are going to link with the restaurant in Basel as well, I'm sure that during the time, don't forget that in 2020, there's only one food and beverage stores available, which is the restaurant
yeah,
bar.
Yeah, so actually I think we are so lucky because of only that period, we can have the show.
Yeah.
And then we can do the tasting.
Absolutely.
And only that moment. After Absolutely. That and before that, is we can't do anything.
But after this experience, I'm sure that no matter what situation upcoming, we still can make it.
Yeah, hopefully.
We can do a lot of different equipment nowadays. Okay, then that's why I'm sure that 2021 will be quite a promising year. And then we really love to see more importers, wineries, cooperatives. Then they get more support, and then absolutely for sure that you get a result. And this result will urge to all Hong Kong and Chinese people. They know about your wine.
Yes, yes, and of course, and in this year, hopefully we can have more judges from overseas, because in the past few years we have different judges from different countries.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And coming this year, definitely if we can get together from the judges from China, from Japan, from Korea, from Australia, France, different country, and then we hopefully can get together and then we have a big tasting again.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for watching the result announcement of WINE.LUXE International Award 2020, and hope to see you next year. And also, of course, this year we have maybe have more wine and more judges and more big party. And stay tuned and see you very soon.
See you very soon.
Thank you.